Let me start by just kind of introducing myself. And the only reason for that is that over lunch, I and some of my compatriots discovered that many people here have not heard of the Afro-Middle East Center, of which I am the executive director. And so I thought I'd take this opportunity to inform you and, of course, just get a bit of free advertising in. The Afro-Middle East Center, AMEC, is a co-host of this conference and is based not in Istanbul, but in Johannesburg in South Africa. It's the only research institute in South Africa that focuses on the Middle East and North Africa region. And our partnership with Sharq Forum dates back for the past 2 years. So one of the most of our activities are in South Africa, where we are based. But one of our activities is an annual conference that we have outside of South Africa. And last year and this year, we've partnered with Sharq Forum to host that in Istanbul. So that's just my ad break. Usually ad breaks would be in the middle, but I started with it. We're on to now the final session of the conference. Thus far, I think, and I'm sure that most of you will agree with me, very stimulating and indeed even productive discussions that have taken place over the past 2 days. I must say that as excited as I am about moderating a panel of these people that are sitting in front of you, because once you read their short bios in the booklet, you'll realize why I'm so excited about moderating this panel. I'm also really glad that I'm sitting on this side rather than that side, because the theme for this session is mapping the new security architecture, the road ahead, which logically is the right note to end on, but I really don't know what these people are going to say or whether they actually have anything to say. And perhaps we should take a cue from the earlier session. Instead of giving each person 8 minutes, just say 2 minutes each, because you have nothing to say, but I'll be generous. So I'm not going to introduce all the speakers. Their little bios are in the booklet. We will take the speakers in the order in which they are sitting, from my immediate left all the way down. Each speaker will speak, as I said, for about 8 minutes on that topic, trying to navigate through that topic. And then we'll open it up for some discussion thereafter. So our first speaker is Kayhan Bazergar. Kayhan is from Iran and director of the Institute for Middle East Strategic Studies in Tehran.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate your invitation. I'm glad to be here as an Iranian academic to share with you some of my views. Despite the old challenges being discussed during yesterday and today about the regional complexity, I would like to mention that there is one opportunity coming out of this equation, and that is the growing multilateralism, which in my belief is the result of a geopolitical urgency in the region. And by that I mean, I put it in a conceptual framework and also in substance, and in the end, I would say that how regional integration will lead towards sustainable peace and security. If you look at the regional developments, let's start from 2003, and then the wars in the region, and then in 2011, the Arab Spring developments, and in 2014, with the emergence of Daesh, the so-called Islamic State. We'll see a kind of, regional equations taking place in the region. We see more regionalization of the situation. And in that sense, I would say that the people of the region are expecting more responsibility from their states. And this is because of the fact that the foreign solution have not been successful. The issue of good governance are the main issue in the region, and of course the emergence of ISIS has brought some internal divisions between states. As a result of this, a new culture of security or political, cultural security is coming to be emerged in the region. And I think that is very important. We all know about this concept of inclusive government. We cannot return to the past of the Arab Spring. We cannot return to the past of ISIS situation. We are talking about the post-conflict situation in the region. But perhaps the more significant characteristic of this geopolitical urgency is the fact that the states feel they have strategic constraints in dealing with the regional issues. And that is becoming the fact we have talked about a lot about the balance of power, one state against another state. In my belief, at the same time, we should think that while these regional equations brought new features and characteristics for the region, at the same time, it brought a lot of challenges, security challenges for a state. And this is not an exception for every state in the region. And I think this is because of the fact that the new security challenges have different nature, like the Daesh. It's a new phenomenon. Of course, it is this economic constraints of a state to engage with the war in the region. For instance, Russia is talking about the exit strategy. I'm sure that Iran has an exit strategy from the regional conflict. And of course, it is the issue of domestic politics, the continuation of this issue, mobilizing domestic forces and people to continue with another involvement outside of the border. And the fact that all the states realize that they need to get to a compromise, because we talk of the third party equation as well, like between Turkey and Russia, and Iranian concerns that how the situation would go ahead, or Turkey concerns about the Iranian-Russian coalitions, or Saudi Arabia's concerned about that. And plus that, we see new societal and, of course, political and economic challenges when we talk of Daesh using energy and its impacts on oil price. These are the constraints that the states are facing. I think this geopolitical urgency is forcing the region to go towards a multilateral diplomacy and approach. And this is something that, in my belief, is an opportunity, and we should build on that. This is the concept that we are witnessing in the region. And at the same time, I think the substance and logic of this multilateralism, growing multilateralism, is coming from the fact that the states are, as I say, I said it previously, that the states are counting on their own national resources. They are thinking that if they, focus on their, domestic and internal resources, they can better develop their foreign policy strategy. And at some extent, I think they are also benefiting from their geopolitical superiority. And this is not an exception that they think that by that they can actually increase their national power, which in my belief is not a bad thing. If we focus on the fact that the states becoming more powerful based on their internal sources, that would benefit the region, because then they can somehow share their energy in addressing common problems like battling terrorism. For instance, I can give you this example that the Iranian nuclear deal was the result of a growing pragmatism inside Iran, and that was connected to the domestic discourses when the Iranian government realized that it needs to somehow balance between its resources so that it can add to its national power. And that was the concept that the Iranian reached to this fact that they need to solve their discrepancies, your strategic discrepancies or conflict with Western power. And that became the main issue. Or Saudi Arabia right now is talking about 2030 perspective or vision, which is based on domestic resources and diversification of the resources or generation change. Of course, we have something which the Saudis might think of benefiting from their geopolitical superiority, and that is following a more assertive policy towards the region, Yemen, or other places, or Turkey. Again, we are here now in Istanbul, and it is not hidden that how much Turkey is somehow connecting its foreign and regional policy with its domestic politics, which is not an exception. I think every government would do that. The result of this, in my belief, is a kind of growing inward looking in the regional states, which is the way towards more integration. I believe that although we have a lot of challenges, but the future is good because the future is something that the regional states are taking more responsibility while they are involved in the regional rivalry or geopolitical rivalry. They realize that they need to adjust their positions with the regional political security realities. And this is something that is happening, and I think this is a good thing. At the end, I think we should understand that how much regional integration is important. Professor Sajjotpour mentioned today that one of the successes of Iran-Turkey relations, the bilateral relations. If, for instance, we can somehow integrate the theme of energy and developmental approach, that could be a good example for regional integration. I think even energy has the potential. It's like Asian development somehow. The combination of development and energy, it's a good theme for dealing with the regional issues, and it brings more stability in the region. A lot of other things, which I think with regional integration, we can reach to a kind of sustainable peace and security, and the way to that is multilateralism, and I think this growing multilateralism is taking place in the region, and it is the future of the region. By that, I stop.
Thank you, Kayhan. I want to make a request. It's a bit unfair, Kayhan. I should have made the request before you started. I know that for most of us who deal with political science, international relations, security studies, we're very focused on states. And I also know that looking around that everyone has prepared pieces of paper in front of them, so you've already decided what you're going to say. Nevertheless, my very unfair request. If you can at all include, as you're speaking in your thinking, what these things might mean beyond just talking about states. I mean, if we talk about regional integration, for example, does that have any meaning beyond just states? I think this has been, over the past 2 days, a kind of thought that has been expressed by a number of people, that we're getting too stuck. And I understand, with a theme like the one we have, we are talking about states. Nevertheless, I want to put this on the table. I know that for the two politicians here, it might be easier to talk about people, because politicians are quite used to making promises to people. But let's try and go beyond that. Next speaker will be Tarik Yousef. Tarik is the director of Brookings Institution, Institute Doha, and senior fellow in the Global Economy and Development at Brookings Institute.
Thank you, Naeem. And thanks to the audience for being with us on a very long day. And thanks to the organizers for making this event happen. Like you, when I looked at the title of the panel, my initial reaction was, well, this should end very quickly. I probably have very little to say. But we've organized the panel, and we've spent 2 days, obviously, debating some of these very broad general themes. I also feel a bit challenged, partly because I'm an economist who looks at particular processes that often are connected with security and political issues, but they have their own logic and their own underlying dynamics. Nonetheless, I've taken the question of the panel seriously. And I asked myself, like many of you, is there a roadmap ahead? Have I heard anything in the last 2 days or learned anything recently that suggests that, in fact, we can map the new architecture? And my first point is that, in fact, there is no roadmap ahead. That the process that one of our colleagues labeled yesterday, the disintegration of the regional order, which has been underway now for not just a few years, some of us would argue that in fact it started probably decades ago. We have yet to see the end of it. We're unlikely to see the end of it anytime soon. So, state disintegration of the regional order, state fragility, failure, collapse, and many of the schisms associated with it that have become almost normal in our lives. Civil strife, political polarization, economic dislocation. It seems, at least from a regional security, an expanded security perspective that includes the political and the economic, that the entire system is unraveling. If that is true, and I think a lot of indicators suggest that that is the case, then this process still has some way to go before it in fact settles. And until that point, mapping the regional, the new regional security architecture is still, I think, a task that will have to await circumstances, time, and a lot of uncertainty about what will happen between now and then. But there is another reason why I think we cannot map out the new security architecture beyond what's happening in the region. I don't think I'm the only one, and this should not come as a surprise to any of you, that the entire international order seems to be unraveling before our very eyes. And in fact, historically, at least the regional order that we have grown up with and have taken for granted goes back to the very inception of the current international system as it was given birth to sometime after World War II. So if you've got a regional order that's unraveling and an international order that is being tested, that is under stress, under threats, and could potentially witness a lot of realignment and a lot of reorderings of existing arrangements, then our own regional order, in fact, will have to, the realignment within has to take place as the international system realigns itself. And that's precisely what happened 70, 80 years ago. It wasn't an automatic process. It wasn't an overnight process. Some of you who probably are more familiar with the history of that time period will recall that it took decades for the regional system as we've known it, the state-centric system, to emerge. There was a lot of unpredictability. There were too many actors at play. There was a lot of international competition between powers that were on the decline, some colonial powers, and the new powers that emerged. And in fact, there was a lot of local competition as well, between tribes, regions, between Western educated elites, between Islamists, between seculars and liberals. So in my humble opinion, if you accept the first premise that the regional order, as we've known it, is slowly giving way to the emergence of another order, and if you believe that the international system itself is witnessing a realignment, then the two, in fact, will go hand in hand. This process will have to, we will be participants in this process, we can contribute to this process, but this process is not finished. In fact, in some cases, it's only begun. The second point I wanted to make, to only perhaps bring some balance to some of the discussions that has taken place in the last 2 days, is that it's not only the security architecture that requires fixing, requires mapping. It's also the economic architecture of this region, the economic arrangements that have been with us for a very long time, economic arrangements that have been failing, economic arrangements that have in fact highlighted the weaknesses of the state, and in my humble opinion, may have in fact exacerbated the process of state collapse in itself. Some of those issues that will have to be part of this economic realignment and restructuring have to deal with not just existing problems, problems we've inherited, and in my own work in the last 10 years, and some of you is familiar with it, a lot of what violence and terrorism and youth has been about, it has been about economic exclusion, marginalization, disenfranchisement, the symptoms and causes and consequences of which have only gotten worse with time as they've been neglected. But we've got newer issues to deal with. We've got problems that have to that we did not grow up with 20, 30 years ago. Inequality, mobility, economic security, problems that have to do with the basic provision of public services, education and health. that the collapsing state is no longer able to provide because the state's institutions are being hollowed out, they are being degraded, and they're unable to deliver. This also, as part of this economic restructuring, one of the consequences of it and why it is not just a small fix, but a larger problem, the entire conventional wisdom in the world, the so-called neoliberal economic order, is being questioned. In fact, it's in retreat as we speak. Deglobalization has suddenly become attractive. Deindustrialization is a problem. Markets are bad. The end of Davos man. Trump's rhetoric around populism in the West and others is feeding on a lot of economic insecurity, which is going to be part, in my view, of the larger security architecture of the region and the world.
What, 1 minute?
Final point, and I'll take 1 minute to
thank you
to try to sort of sum this up. What do we do meanwhile? So if this process underway will still need time before it settles, and it's really not just about security arrangements, it's about a host of political arrangements, I would argue societal arrangements, a remaking of a system, so to speak. What do we do meanwhile, especially when we know that international actors will have a very important role to play in this? I think one thing we can do, and this came out of our discussion yesterday, was to try to contain the damage that's being done, not just to the security arrangements. I think this discussion is far beyond the states at the moment. It's about societies. It's about our locales, our villages, our towns, our sense of trust, relationships amongst neighbors. That's what's happening as states collapse in a lot of the countries where we've witnessed non-state actors emerge and civil wars escalate. But we can do more, perhaps, than just contain the damage. We can possibly anticipate the emerging new arrangements in the world. At the global level, at the regional level, we should anticipate those discussions. We should be part of the thinking. We should be part of the new narratives. We should be, in fact, acting to map out what is likely to emerge as the system produces new arrangements, new expectations. But we can, in fact, even do more than that. I think we need to speak about new visions for this region, new visions for our society, new visions for our for state-society relations, new visions for how sectarianism can be dealt with, how we bring about reconciliation, how we bring about national dialogue, how we engineer processes of reconstruction in the countries that have suffered a lot of damage. And I think as part of this, we have to go to some of the fault lines that have made themselves quite visible in our region in the last 5 to 10 years. The polarization, the sources of it, this schism between liberal and secular, between Sunni and Shia, the structural flaws in how our societies have coexisted with our societies and gradually undermined us and weakened us. We have to deal with these boldly, honestly, and we should avoid what happened 100 years ago when the regional system was put in place. We should not suppress our problems. We should deal with them up front. Suppressing our problems and pretending they don't exist only led to them fermenting, festering, as somebody indicated earlier, and them emerging eventually during moments of vulnerability and insecurity and state failure in the ugliest of forms. We should also, by way of thinking and avoiding historical mistakes, and this is the final comment from, we should not outsource the reconstruction of our regional arrangements, the societal, the economic, and political. We should not outsource them to our elites. We did that 100 years ago. It produced arrangements that have worked, but it also established a lot of structural flaws that made it very difficult for us to reform, to fix, to bring about the renewal that was needed. The process needs to be much more inclusive, needs to be bottom up, and it needs to include everyone that is concerned with the future that hopefully many of us will be a part of helping to establish the parameters for in the future.
Tarik, you know, the only reason I let you carry on for longer was because you're an economist. But I didn't think I would say this, but it seems like it takes an economist in this discussion to make it more sobering, more bring in more realism, but together with that, more hope. That did sound a little more hopeful than some of the other discussions we had. Not to say you were not hopeful, Kayhan. You were, but in a different way. Okay, our next speaker is Said Ferjani, a fellow African. Welcome, Said. Said is the advisor to the head of the Ennahdha Central Committee. That's the Ennahdha party in Tunisia, which over the past 7 years has been in and out of government a few times, and always happy to be in government and always happy to be out of government. In government at the moment?
Yeah.
Will you still be in tomorrow?
Anyway,
Said, go on.
Thank you very much for having me. I think I want to go to the point, and albeit I'm really pleased to hear for the economic dimension. The regional powers, what is a regional power? A regional power is, the regional powers are those playing or influencing security beyond their borders. In this regard, it means Saudi Arabia, it means Iran, it means Turkey, it means Egypt in the Middle East, and later on Middle Egypt in North Africa, as well as the Emirates and Qatar. So Israel as well is influencing the occupied territories as many other countries in the Middle East. Whilst in North Africa, we got Egypt and Algeria in particular, influencing Libya with different direct impacts. Other organizations that they are powers who are non-state organizations, in my opinion, Hezbollah and Hamas. Albeit they have power beyond the influence things, sometimes beyond their borders. However, there are a few points I want to make. In my opinion, ISIS is a new product in the very few years, in the last very few years. And objectively, it has to be looked at as a consequence rather than a root cause. It has to be transformed as a root cause, threatening security, but in itself, it's a byproduct of situation which is a very bad situation indeed. So some of the main root causes, in my opinion, authoritarian regimes that brings oppression, injustices, lack of the rule of law. So wherever there is alienation of specific community, generation, or people, you can expect the worst. So something, call it ISIS, call it Qaeda, call it I don't know what, to react. Since the state, when it makes itself lawless, it means that it has to expect the reaction. This is not to say that ISIS should not be fought.
It has to be fought, but the root causes.
Where's your little thing?
No, it has stopped.
The whole system has gone out.
The whole, whole system collapsed like the regional thing.
It needs some regional integration, audio integration.
Okay. No, I think it's back.
It's very good.
No.
Okay.
Yes. Recovered.
So wherever there is the lack, the deficit of sense of belonging to the state, of specific or particular group or persons, then we can expect terrorists and all the other things that they are not welcomed and nice for any given country. There are another point that I want to make, that the main players themselves, sometimes we are in denial to accept what's right in the other competitor, or the competitor itself, they are in denial to accepting that they are making few things wrong. So I want to be, I'll take a case study, Iran. In my opinion, Iran has generated fear in its Arab region during its revolution, because people, when they've seen the revolution, they were scared from it. It's not because it's wrong to have a revolution, but on the contrary, but that's the situation. So and it was exactly like the Arab Spring, because the Arab Spring has generated fear in many authoritarian regimes that they are still working to topple and to make a lot of things against even the last one, which is Tunisia. And even the problems in Libya and others, they are not alien to these things. So the rejection of Iran by the Gulf states and its neighbors, in particular during the, has taken advantage or pushed to the Iraq-Iran war, which was against Iran. So Iran has built its own security architecture based upon mainly its own arm industry, coupled with relying as well upon building its own strategy, economy, and something else that which is very questionable is satellite Shia groups in many other countries, like Hezbollah, Houthis, and others, plus different groups in Iraq, in Afghanistan, and the East. So other countries, the other competitors, they feel they are under pressure from this. So in order to look at the regional arrangements, we have to understand each other, what is, from where it's hurt, or what this regional player has done wrong vis-a-vis the other, and then we can talk really candidly about what should be done. Solution, when we look, for example, if we wish to have a solution, it must be, the economic interrelations must be allowed to be fluid, whatever the problems they are there. Second, the states must observe the human rights of its own citizens, no matter who they are, and no matter their religious affiliation. And all the region, we have a huge diversity, because what I'm really scared of, the nightmare scenario, is what we are seeing in Syria, and previously little of it or a lot of it in Iraq. Maybe it's not the end, because the components and the mix-up and the makeup of Iran, of Turkey, of the region, is a mixed. It's very mixed in itself. So it is important to really do not play with fire when you are supreme and when you are strong, to try to inflict things upon the other. The non-state groups must not be allowed to challenge the states with arms ever, even under dictatorship. Because dictatorship doesn't allow you to take arms, otherwise there would be an endless problem. The region must have a roadmap to achieve security. If there is no roadmap and it has to be discussed, and whether I have to point out that the least one, which is the most reliant on itself in security, in my opinion, is Iran. Turkey has a mixed thing, and maybe it's better than the others, and the others, they have external. They are consuming security from the external, from foreigners or from other region and internationally. And this problem means that any security arrangements in the region must take into consideration these things. There is no, we cannot really escape from talking to each other and finding solutions, and stopping the Shia making da'wah amongst the Sunnis, and Sunnis within Shia. And for example, you have the Shia, the allegiance of any Shia is for a Shia country, or a Sunni allegiance is for a Sunni country. Last, we have to understand as well that we have to work out internationally, that we should be really friendly to some extent about and to discuss our arrangements that should be produced by the regional powers with the EU, the US, Russia, China, UK, and even India in order to have a lasting formula for the future. And thank you.
Thank you, Said. I noticed that our tradition is that we don't applaud for speakers. It's very strange. Thank you for the one person who applauded. Our next speaker will be Ibrahim Turhan. Ibrahim is a member of the Turkish Parliament, former chairperson and CEO of the Istanbul Stock Exchange. So we have another of the kind of economist type perspective, yeah. Ibrahim.
Thank you, Naim. I'm really glad to be here. So let me first thank to the organizers of this event for inviting me. Now it has been a tradition for me. It's my the third time, if I'm not wrong, to be in a panel in the Sharq Forum. Well, to your appointment, Naim, first of all, I'm not going to talk too much about the state or politics. And when I say too much, as much as a politician can avoid it, of course. But rather, I'm going to talk about money. You know, there is a very good film, movie, actually a series of movies.
I said you must talk about people, not money.
But money and people are convertible to each other. There's a reciprocity between money and people. Anyway, there is a movie, as you know, Die Hard. Money, the movie of Bruce Willis. It's a series of movies, actually. And in each episode, there is a cliche. And at a certain point, Bruce Willis comes out and say, it's money, my friend, and always money. So let's try to focus on the money component of the security issue. And another maybe warning that I should do, since that we have two economists in the same panel. When you have two economists, you'll end up at least with three different ideas. This is by nature, by construction, but I have nothing to do about it.
That's richness.
Yes. And it's not a common good in our region, by the way, my brother, to have different ideas. Anyway, so we are talking about security. And when it comes to security and MENA region is concerned, of course, we have to consider about peace building, because peace and security are really the two things, two factors that go hand by hand, side by side in our region. So how can we contribute to peace building, or how can we contribute to restore the peace and security in a region such as MENA? And of course, once we'll get there will be another issue, that is to make sure that it will be sustainable and long-lasting. Well, I think there is a common consensus about the role of the economy in the peace building. So we know that prosperity, economic wealth, and high growth really contribute to the peace and security. When you have those things, high growth, of course, inclusive growth, preferably, and economic wealth, then it will be easier to restore and sustain peace and security. So what can we do about it? Of course, when we are talking about peace and security in the MENA region, we, of course, always keep in mind that at least four layers are concerned. First layer is intergovernmental peace and security. So because there are conflicts between nation states So this is the first layer. The second layer is the security issue or peace between the government or regime and its people. The third one is the security or conflict as a threat to security originating from amorphous elements, as you just said, like Daesh or other terrorist organizations in the region. And fourth is the threat to security, threat to peace originating from foreign forces or global forces like US, Russia, China, etc. Of course, I am a humble man, and in my very humble capacity, I cannot deal all of those issues. But at least, if we can bring a perspective of economy, two layers, intergovernmental and intragovernmental peace and security issues can be handled relatively more easier. And how can we do this? Well, of course, thanks to the theories about peace building, the role of the economy in peace building, going back to the pre-war period, we know that there are two approaches, orthodox approaches, that can help to restore and then maintain peace and security. First, natural disaster approach, as we had in, for example, Hurricane Katrina. When you have a disaster, natural disaster, of course, it poses a threat to the security, and you know how to deal with it. Another approach is the so-called post-war stabilization. We know the Marshall Plan after the Second World War, how everybody worked together in order to restore the security in, for example, Europe, and also after the collapse of the Soviet system. Again, there were attempts to restore peace and security in the region. And there are more recent approaches, like institutional approach, so which says that before liberalizing the region, you need first to build the institutions, or emergency approaches, so early recovery. So you should first target the immediate needs of people before thinking about the other things. I'll try to propose another thing. Taking my capacity as the CEO and chairman of Borsa Istanbul, because we created a small model of it. And this is all about the entrepreneurship. How we can support and actually enhance the entrepreneurial ability of people, common people, without maybe thinking too much about the government, the state, the war, etc. Is it possible really to support entrepreneurial ability of people? This is the first thing. The second thing, as you know, there are two categories in our region who are the victims of lack of security. Those are women and youth. So is it possible to develop a mechanism to address directly to those two strata, those two groups, women and youth, to empower them and to create an inclusive environment in the economy where those two subgroups would play a more determining role so that their relative situation would improve. And in order to reach those aims, as Borsa Istanbul, we developed a very special market to bring together angel investors, crowdfunding, things like that, and special kind of financing for earlier stage of investment, earlier stage of entrepreneurship. They are not looking really making a lot revenue. They are not looking really to generate too much money out of the investment. But they are providing investment, supporting innovation, microcredit to enable especially women to become an integrated part of the economic life. Of course, I am totally aware that compared to the big issues, really big threats, what I'm talking are really very minor issues. But I am aware, on the other hand, that if we wait until those big issues to be solved or to be addressed, believe me, ladies and gentlemen, it will be too late. So in my opinion, it's better to take a step today, maybe a small one, maybe a minor one, humble one, but to deliver something concrete for the good of people in the region to improve the security and peace of the region. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ibrahim. Perhaps in light of your comments, I should just say what I was going to say at the end after the last speaker. In terms of your comment about the focus on women and youth, I think we started off on a really bad note. I always feel very unhappy to speak on a panel where there's only men. I feel ashamed to be chairing and to be actually responsible for a panel that has only men. So I take my share of the responsibility for this and apologize to you all that we have only men on this panel. And now from one of those external countries that is a threat to peace in our region. Oh, well, not our region, I'm not from here. Vasily Kuznetsov is head of the Center for Arab and Islamic Studies at the Oriental Institute in Moscow.
Thank you. I want to talk about economics. Firstly, let me thank Sharq Forum and Dr. Jeenah for the possibility to be here today. And I'm sorry if my intervention will be a little bit depressive and pessimistic. Firstly, I think that while talking about new regional security system, we should take into consideration that we're talking about a first regional security system, because everything what existed here earlier was based on non-regional players, non-regional pillars, like Soviet Union, United States, colonial powers, and so on. And but there is, while I was writing this text, I noticed there is one very interesting thing. When regional actors try to create something, to create some regional system, their own, it always was made by negative way. It always was an exclusive system. It always was a way of support friendship against somebody, against Iran, against Israel, against somebody else. Why? Is it a result only of external intervention, external involvement in the region? Or there is some specificity in political culture of a MENA region? I don't know, really, but I think that it is a very important question, and we should think about it. Even today, while we talk about new regional security system, we began our talks about, from the war against terrorism or war against ISIL, Daesh. It's an ideal enemy for everybody. Terrorism is better than Daesh because terrorism is absolutely abstract, abstraction. So to struggle against abstraction is good. But objectively, today the external involvement in the region is much less than it ever was. Now it is strange that it is Russian who tell it, but nevertheless. And today the regional players are learning to manage the region. They are in train to understand the limits of their powers. the limits of their foreign ambitions. And I think that in these circumstances, there are four clusters of the more important problems which make a situation very fragile. The first is the lack of experience, of course. And nobody knows how much time they need, regional actors needs to take this experience. The second is the weakness, of every regional actors. We have so many candidates for regional leadership because of the weakness of everybody. Every state of the region can pretend to be a leader. And by the same reason, all of them, or most of them, always looks for some external support. Non-regional support, I want to say. The third problem is internal fragility of every country, political, economical, social, identical, and so on. Maybe sometimes it is not a real fragility, objective fragility, but it is a sense, a feeling of fragility. And one of the consequences of this fragility is a very specific role of religious identities in the region. Confessional activism of Shia groups, of Salafist groups, is percepted by the governments in several countries as a domestic threat. But in the same time, it is a form to express protest of the population against injustice, against bad governance, and so on. And it always was. If we look at the history of the region, Islamic history of the region, always the protest popular movements were Shia or Salafist. So it doesn't deny the fact that some powers try to instrumentalize this confessional activism, but you can't instrumentalize something what doesn't exist. So it is a problem of the governments. It is a problem of the good governance. And the fourth problem is the cluster, is the total mistrust. It is mistrust not only in intergovernmental relations, but in social relations too, in relations between the government and society. And this mistrust is the start point for polarization, for fragmentation, for marginalization, for exclusivism, and so on. And of course, we can't do something, you can't do something with all these structural problems today. They need time. But from the other side, something must be done. I think about the following. Firstly, I think that on the basic level, there is need in some multilateral dialogue on three subjects. And this dialogue can become a bridge to trustness. The first subject is a common values, common vision of the future. Politically, talk, common strategy, common narrative. Without it, what kind of the Middle East do they want? How it look like? It's a liberal, or it is something else? And what do you mean by liberal and democracy? I have heard today and yesterday a lot of times they talk about democracy, but what do you mean by democracy in Yemen, for example, or in Iraq? Without, maybe you mean something, or maybe it is only a word. The second subject is the common threats. Water problem, food problem, demographic problem, and so on. In the situation of overpopulation of the region and lack of resources, conflictual potential of the region will increase. And we should accept this fact. And we should work with the exception of this fact. And the third, and I think it is much better enemy than terrorism. And the third subject Is economic cooperation, social economic interaction, development of regional economic institutions, and so on, restoration of destroyed regions, but up the set level, this level, very theoretical maybe level, I think that there is a need in some inclusive regional agreement, political agreement, about basic principles of coexistence. There are some principles. Revision of borders is unacceptable. I think that every country of the region can be, state of the region can be agree with it. Sovereign nation states are the only legitimate actors in the security system. Yeah, there is Hamas, there is Hezbollah, but they are part of states, governments. Interferences in domestic affairs is unacceptable. The governments must be responsible for equality of all the segments of their population, and so we can discuss some other principles. These principles will create some framework for common political work. But in the same time, in parallel with all this, there is a building of a new security system ad hoc now. And it is on the basis of conflict resolution. We can see Syria, Yemen, Libya. There are not very much very good results, but there is a process. And in this process, regional track is the most important. And we can see it in Syria. But we can see also that regional track can be effective and can work only with non-regional mediation and facilitation. And Russia, Piper Tiger, said today, try to play this role of facilitator, of mediator. It will try. And using diplomatic, political, and military tools too, of course. And the last point, I think that all these things can be done, and much more can be done, with only one circumstance. If regional political elites understand that that it is dangerous, that alarmism in foreign policy is dangerous, that wars cost too much to them. Without this fear, without this understanding, nothing can be done. That's all.
Thank you, Vasily. As I said earlier, for those who might not have been here when I said so, our next speaker will speak in Turkish. So if you don't understand Turkish, please get your headphones. And the next speaker is Nihat Ali Özcan.
Özcan. Bugünkü, thank you very much, Chairman. Bugünkü son konuşmacı benim. Dolayısıyla hem şeylerin, tercüme edenlerin kapasitesini ölçelim, hem de kapanışta Türkçe kullanalım diye. Ben konuşmamı Türkçe yapacağım. Sanırım herhalde bir kulaklık torunu var. Şimdi hepimiz güvenlikle ilgili iki gündür tartışmaları ve konuşmaları dinliyoruz. Şimdi bu konuda konuştuğumuz ve tartıştığımız konuları pratikte bir meseleye ve meseleyi çözme konusunda nasıl kullanacağız ya da kapasitemizin ne olduğu konusu üzerinde tartışıyoruz. Şimdi bu noktada birinci öncelikle bakmamız gereken karşı karşıya olduğumuz konu bir defa homojen karakterde bir problem değil. Biz şu anda mozaik bir problemi konuşuyoruz. Mozaik bir problem derken, Kuzey Afrika'dan Orta Doğu'nun ortasına, Arap Yarımadası'nın kuzeyinden Anadolu içlerine kadar karşı karşıya kaldığımız problemin karakteri birbirinden farklı. Dolayısıyla da farklı karakterdeki bir sorunu kapsayacak ve çözüm üretecek tek bir tane strateji yok. Demek ki farklı taktiklerden, farklı araçlardan, farklı yaklaşımlardan bazı şeyler üretmemiz lazım. Mesela bunlardan bazıları etnik, Kürt meselesinden söz ediyorsanız, farklı karakterde Irak'ta bir Kürt meselesi var. Suriye'de var, devam ediyor. Türkiye'de var ve öbür taraftan İran'da var. Ya da öbür taraftan baktığınızda bir Filistin-İsrail meselesi var farklı karakterde. Yine işte DAEŞ'ten söz ediyoruz, Şii-Sünni ilişkilerinden farklı. Daha bunu zor hale getiren veya daha da zor hale getiren konu ise aktörlerin birbirinden farklı olmasıyla ilgili konu. Yani bir taraftan devletler arasındaki meseleyi tartışıyoruz. Aynı anda devletlerin kendi içinde ya da devletlerin sınırını aşan sorunları konuşuyoruz. Şimdi bütün bunların hepsine çarenin tek olması mümkün değil gibi gözüküyor. O halde mevcut güvenlik durumundan, mimarisinden hoşnut değilsek, bizi çatışmaların ya da bu tür güvenlik sorunlarından kurtararak tehdit altında olmadığımız hissi yaratacak bir iklimi, bir ortamı nasıl yaratırız diye bir soruyla karşı karşıyayız. Şimdi soru şu, bu işin sorumuzu kim ve kimler? Yani biz bu mimarinin inşasını kimlerden bekleyeceğiz? Eğer biraz önce çok söylenen küresel aktörlerse bunlar, küresel aktörler şu anda çok meşgul. Yani Amerika Birleşik Devletleri'nin sizin bu bölgedeki bir mimariden çok ortaya çıkan güvensizlik ve tehditleri kendisine olan kısımlarını ortadan kaldırmaya uğraşıyor. Dolayısıyla bir mimariden çok su patlağını onarmaya gelen bir muslukçu gibi davranıyor. Şimdi öbür taraftan baktığınızda Rusya ise tarihsel olarak kaybettiklerini yerine koymanın derdinde. Bir mimariden falan veya mimarın inşasından çok buradaki var olan sorunların farklı boyutlara ve ölçeklere ve farklı yere gitmesiyle ilgileniyor. Avrupa Birliği ise daha çok kendisini içine dönmüş ve kendisini rahatsız eden konularla ilgileniyor. O halde demek ki bu küresel bağlamdaki güvenlik mimarisinin ne olduğuna dair bir fikir netleşinceye kadar bölgedeki mimarinin ne olacağı konusunda çok da net bir şey söylemek mümkün değil gibi gözüküyor. Öte yandan ikincisi, bu mimariyi inşa etmeye niyetlenenler bunu hangi sütunlar üzerinde yükseltecek? Geçmişte Orta Doğu'da bu tür barışı ya da güvensizliği ortadan kaldırmaya dair 90'lı yıllarda yapılan bazı girişimler ve onlardan çıkaracak bazı dersler var. Şüphesiz ki ekonomik entegrasyon gibi. Ya da değerler mi üreteceğiz? Yok sadece ekonomi ya da güvenlikle ilgili bir takım ittifaklar mı geliştireceğiz? Yoksa bununla beraber bazı ortak anlayışlara doğru mu gideceğiz? Şimdi bununla gittiğimiz zaman da tartıştığımız bayağı bir konular var. Maliyeti kim üstlenecek? Çünkü sonuçta bir mimari ortaya çıkarmak istiyorsanız bunun bir maliyeti olacak. Bakın biliyorsunuz şu anda Amerika Birleşik Devletleri ile Avrupa'daki NATO üyesi ülkeler arasında güvenlikle ilgili harcamalar konusunda derin tartışmalar devam ediyor. Bunun yanı sıra diğer tarafa baktığım zaman şunu görmem mümkün. Farklı karakterde aktörlerden söz ettik. Şimdi eğer bu mimarinin, siyasi mimarinin bir parçası yeni devletler ya da devlet dışı aktörlerin devlete sahip olmasıysa, o zaman bununla ilgili gelişmelerin ortaya çıkardığı sorunların üstesinden nasıl geleceğiz? Ve belki de en önemli boyutlardan birisi, bu mimari ne kadar yılda ve sürede inşa edilecek ve sorunlarımızı ne kadar sürede üstesinden gelecek? Şu andaki mevcut tabloya baktığımızda Orta Doğu'daki diğer sorunlara, maalesef bu mevcut karşılaştığımız sorunlar karakteri icabı çok uzun yıllar ancak üstesinden gelecek hadiseler. Yani bir Filistin-İsrail meselesi, bir Irak'taki 1980'de başlayan İran-Irak Savaşı'nın getirdiği istikrarsızlığın ve güvensizliğin yarattığı süreç ve bölgedeki diğer sorunlara baktığımızda bunun üstesinden ancak uzun yıllarda gelebileceğimizi görüyoruz. Sonuç olarak bir taraftan yoksulluğun, göçün ve mülteci meselesinin, iklim değişikliğinin, baskıcı rejimlerin, su kıtlığının, zenginliğin adaletsizlik olarak dağıtıldığı bir ülkede, bölgede küreselleşme, terör, iç savaş, sivil savaş gibi sorunların ortaya çıkardığı bu genel tablo ancak kendi hızını doğal olarak kaybettiği bir noktadan itibaren mimarinin inşasına başlayabileceğimizi düşünüyorum. Yoksa aksi takdirde bölgesel aktörlerin kendi çıkarlarını, küresel gelişmelerin dikkatini sadece Orta Doğu'ya ve Orta Doğu'nun bu sorunlarına sarf edemeyeceğini. Bu çerçevede baktığımızda sorunun özellikle terörizm ve insani dramlar gibi Batı'yı rahatsız etmedikçe onların Orta Doğu'daki güvenlik sorunlarına samimi biçimde rol üstlenebileceklerini çok da sanmıyorum. Dolayısıyla bütün bu tabloya baktığımızda evet Orta Doğu'da bir şu anda bir mimari var. Yıkılmak üzere olan ya da en azından doğrudan ayakta duran ama bütün bu çabalar bize yakın gelecekte herkesin rıza gösterebileceği bir güvenlik mimarisinin olamayacağı gibi bir anlamda bir kötümser bir bakış açısını da beraberinde getiriyor. Dolayısıyla herhalde bu uluslararası aktörlerden çok eğer bu mimarinin ana malzemesi devletler olacaksa o zaman devletlerin kendi kapasitelerini, kendileri arasındaki işbirliğini daha da geliştirerek bu sorunların üstesinden gelmesi gerekiyor diye düşünüyorum. Teşekkür ederim.
Thank you very much. Thank you.